Vanessa and I got back from our little vacation yesterday afternoon, and so you missed us last week. The elders sent us on a vacation, and I'm so grateful to them for taking good care of us. We were pretty tired, and life can wear you out, and so we went on a vacation and rested and ate too much. We went on I guess it was 9 full days on an Italian cruise ship. And I usually don't eat a lot of carbs because it's not good for me. And my shirt is untucked for a reason. I was real worried because I grew up with 5 sisters, right? And, you know, they were always trying to squeeze into their jeans, you know, at least back in the 70s, that's what you did, you know. And I'd always see my sisters laying down on the bed to get their jeans buttoned. And it works. It works, man. So if you find yourself in a jam, you didn't know that, did it? It is. But sure appreciate Dave McCall preaching for me last week. I haven't had a chance to listen to it, but I know it was a blessing to you. If you're a visitor with us, we're so grateful that you're here. And when you feel comfortable, we ask that you would fill out the visitor card so that we can communicate with you. I want to give you a little update on my health condition. I know most of you who are regular attenders have been following for the last 9 months. I did a real expensive genetic test to kind of just see if they could discover what the cause of the peripheral neuropathy I have in my hands, arms, legs, feet. And just before we left, they said the genetic test did not show any, give them any reason to understand what was going on. So I immediately started to cry because it was just like overwhelming. I'm not like super emotional person, but I was like, come on, Lord, you know, 9 months, I need an answer. I'm getting worse, you know. And the poor doctor was like uncomfortable. And so I got over that and I said, okay, if this were you and this was happening to you, what would you do? And, you know, like what would you do? Where would you go? And so the short of it is I'm meeting with a neurosurgeon on the 27th, so a week from tomorrow. I think that's what it is. Anyways, something like that. I meet with a neurosurgeon. She wants me to go in for a deep nerve and tissue biopsy. So they're going to go in above the ankle, surgically go in, find the nerve, cut out about a half inch of nerve and surrounding tissue so they can try to see what exactly is happening to the large nerves that's causing them to give out. So I don't know exactly what day that procedure is, but the surgeon wanted to see me. And there's a risk behind that surgery that when they cut out the nerve, you could lose all your feeling. But I've lost probably 80% of the feeling in that left leg anyways, so it's worth it. And then the second step is I'm going to be going to the Mayo Clinic in May. And the Mayo Clinic has a neurological department that's tops. And what you do, I think it's the 27th of May, they asked me to come for 5 to 7 business days. So I'll be gone for probably 2 weeks. And they get a team of doctors together and they go over all your labs and MRIs and your reports. And then they collaborate, like, what can we do? Or what should we do? And you have an intensive time with them for that period of time. So I'm encouraged that at least, you know, we're doing what we need to do. And in the meantime, just trusting, God, I don't want you to be discouraged. We're just trusting that the Lord is going to use this for good. Romans 8:28 says, you know, all things work together for good that to them who love him and are called according to his purpose. And you and I go through circumstances in our lives and we say, well, what's the good in this? But that's always from our human perspective, isn't it? Because we sit there and our heart breaks and, you know, we're distressed and it's not always health things. Sometimes it's relational and, just economic struggles. And we say, what's the good in this? But it's not that all the things that happen in our life are good. It's that God uses them, that they're not wasted. Even our mistakes are not wasted. That God uses them for good. Because we are His who are called according to His purpose. We love Him and we're called according to purpose. So we can know that even when we don't understand God's working in our lives. Now, we are looking at the cities of refuge. Now, Israel had been given six cities. There were three on one side and three on the other. And they called them cities of refuge so that when there was someone had committed a murder, they could flee to that city and the avenger wasn't allowed to come in and do them any harm. But I wanted you to see that these cities were a picture of where do we run. Because you know, friends, that we live in a world that wants you to run to where you can't find satisfaction. So the world calls you to run to alcohol or calls you to run to drugs or pornography or overeating or, you know, whatever, because it says run here and you'll find satisfaction, but it only brings death. And 2 weeks ago, we looked at the first city, which was Kadesh, and that means Christ, our righteousness, the Lord, our righteousness. When you look for righteousness on your own, you can't ever find it, can you? Right? Because you look to establish a righteousness based on your own behavior, there's always inconsistency. Now, you're usually completely unaware of your inconsistencies, right? Vanessa and I went on this trip, and we had just a blast. It was relaxed and had a great time. But there was a table of where every night you had dinner, and there was a table of six, and you don't really choose who you sit with. You just kind of the lottery. And it was interesting to me that there were two single girls who were at our table sometimes, usually about an hour and 15 minutes late, and they had dietary restrictions, which is fine, cool, right? They wouldn't eat pork, and they wouldn't eat, which is fine, right? No problem. But they always had a pack of cigarettes on their table, and I was like, maybe bacon's bad for you, but it makes you happy. But what's going to kill you quicker, right? And there was just, you know, just kind of like, if you seek to establish righteousness through your own behavior, there's always going to be horrible inconsistencies. So we're not fleeing to ourselves. We're fleeing to Him who is our righteousness. Now, the second city, and you'll find these in 1 Chronicles and in Joshua, the second city of refuge was Shechem. And that means the shoulder. Now, I was sitting there on vacation, and I'm sitting there going, why would we flee to the shoulder? And God kind of gave me something, and that's what the message is going to be. And we're going to look at Luke chapter number 15, verse 3 through 7, as the good shepherd who puts us on His shoulder. I wasn't sure about the significance of it, but God points us back to Christ, who is our good shepherd. So let's look at Luke 15, verse 3 through 7. It'll be on here if you don't bring your Bible. It says, So He told them this parable. What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? Think about that. That should stir your soul. Because He pursues you until you are willing to be found. We think that it's all about us and what we do, but it's not. You have a good shepherd, and when you're wandering in your lostness, He comes after you, and He pursues you. And then He says, and when He has found it, He lays it on His shoulders, rejoicing. And when He comes home, He calls together His friends and His neighbors, saying to them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost. Just so, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Well, Father, I thank You for Your wonderful love, and thank You for the folks that are here, and I pray just now that Your Spirit would begin to do a work in us to open our understanding. And Lord, I pray that each one would know You as their Savior, as their good shepherd. And Lord, that we would quit running and let You pick us up. and put us on your shoulders at the place of rest. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, he starts off, he told them a parable. Now, if you have time today and you can go back and look in Luke, there's three parables of the lost. And Renee, it's so good to see you. Renee's here. Yeah, she took a long vacation from us, but she's back, and we're glad to have you. There's three parables about being lost. There was the lost coin, the lost sheep, and the lost son. Now, there's something that God showed me that's just so amazing about all of the things. The lost coin, the lost sheep, and the lost son, none of those who are lost, none of those things are lost, do anything to be found. Isn't that amazing? Because in our mind, well, I've got to get my act together. I've got to conjure up some kind of penance. I've got to do some kind of work to reveal a true repentance. I've got to get my act together. Then I'm going to come to God. And I've had people tell me that. I'm going to say, listen, when I'm not living like I should right now, so when I get my act together, then I'm going to come to God. I'm like, well, that's not how it works. That's just not how it works. He's saying the lost coin does nothing to be found. You are not the one who's sweeping the house looking for the coin. The good shepherd was the one who was looking for it. You weren't looking for him. You know, we talk about the seeker-sensitive church where we change everything around so that the church is a friendly place for seekers. Now, I'm all for having a friendly place, and I hope that you find this to be a friendly place. But the problem is no one's seeking. We're hiding. Adam and Eve, when they sinned, they didn't go seeking God. What did they do? They hid in some bushes and made clothes out of leaves. And God came to them and said, Adam, where are you? He didn't go to God. He didn't say, Lord, we blew it, man. We're just coming clean here. We blew it and we messed this thing up already. No, they hid and tried to find fig leaves that they could cover their nakedness. The woman loses her coin. She sweeps and she searches the whole house until the coin is found and rejoices. And the shepherd looks for the one sheep. He cares about you as an individual. He seeks you out until he finds you. Even in the story of the prodigal, we call the prodigal the lost son. The Lord, the father, the loving father, lets him go because he gives us this incredible thing we call free will, but maybe better described as free choice. And he doesn't violate our free choices, and he lets us make dumb decisions. He allows us to seek refuge where it can't be found. And so we look in drugs, and we look in alcohol, and we look in overeating, and we look in pornography to find, to satisfy what cannot satisfy us. And he allows us to make these decisions because when at the end of our cells, when we've run out of energy, when we are exhausted and unable to resist, there he finds us. It struck me that, you know, as I was meditating on this passage, that the very things that we look for wholeness are the very things that distract us, right? Like, so the idea we're a connected culture, right? How many of you guys got an iPhone? I got one. I'm cool. Man, I live with this thing handcuffed to my life. If you send me a text message, man, I got to send you a response, even if it's in the middle of my message. Not really. I'm just kidding. But the temptation is there, right? Like, well, right after, why? Because I think if I ever get behind, I will never catch up. I got to stay connected to people if I'm going to be a good shepherd. And so I go on this trip, and I don't have connectivity. I mean, that phone went in the safe and stayed there for 2 days at a time. That's a detox right there, 2 days. Actually, I got a signal somewhere, and I sent a text to Pastor Wayne, and he goes, turn your phone off. Now, what God was showing me was that it's just the way opposite of the way we think. You see, we think the way to be connected is to stay connected, to stay in tune, to stay, you know, aware. And so we are watching Fox News or MSNBC or we're, you know, and constantly watching the trailers, even though we've seen the news cycle. You know, they've said everything they've got to say in 15 minutes. The other 10 hours that you watch it a day are probably not productive. But you're sitting there trying to stay connected because you think, if I could just accumulate enough information, then I'll be okay. But the gospel is leading us to the place of a disconnection. Because when we disconnect, we actually connect. And I think we fill our lives with technology and information and, you know, whether it's our iPad or our iPhone. And, so, you know, I know some of you rebels have to have a Galaxy, what is it called, 7? Samsung Galaxy. I'm so tech savvy, right? Not. but we think we, you know, we got to have all this stuff because we think that's the only way we're going to be safe. But the reality is that's where we're lost. We are so much we are so much like sheep who are barking orders at our shepherd instead of sheep who are listening to their shepherd. And that's why I encourage you, as a part of your spiritual disciplines, to have times of silence, because that's the only way you're ever going to hear God speaking to you. The evangelical world thinks that it's all about what we know, and information is important, but information only leads to a transactional Christianity, where God is trying to lead us to a transformational Christianity. He calls us, he says, listen, he says he leaves the 99 in the open country and he goes after the one that is lost until he finds it. If you're here this morning, the whole purpose of the Lord is to draw you into himself. And he's saying, let me find you. It's not that he doesn't know where you are. It's just that you have to come tired enough to where you'll lay down. And this is the opposite of our culture, right? Because we think, well, I can do it. We get exhausted, we get tired, we come to the place of frustration, and say, well, just let me rest here, and then I'll get stronger. Let me do this, and then I'll be able to do this. Give me this, Lord, and I'll be able to give this back to you. And we negotiate these deals with God that God is completely disinterested in. Because it's not just more information. He wants to bring about transformation. And transformation will never be our experience until we become disconnected from all the things that distract us from God. I think the information is all about numbing us so that we really never have to deal with the issues that are there. Right? Keep all the busyness. Keep the text going. Keep the Facebook. Keep the Instagram. What am I missing? There's a lot of other stuff out there that I'm not tech savvy enough to, right? And we got the Twitter, don't forget Twitter. Our fearless leader is there on Twitter, solving the world's problems in 140 characters. Really? Really? Come on, people. What's that all about? It's about being numb. It's about coming to the place where our lives are so filled and so chaotic that we don't have to deal with any of our personal issues or struggles. We want it all to be a transaction where I do this, now God's obligated to me to do this for me. But that doesn't work, does it? You say, well, Pastor, what do you mean? Well, I'm a missionary. I give my life. I leave the business world behind. I give my life to serve the Lord. I go to be a missionary in the jungles of Thailand and then, in Vietnam, and I go, all these people, well, then obviously God owes me something. I made all of these sacrifices, so God owes me something. Oh, really? Now, we don't say that kind of stuff. It just kind of goes on in the back of our mind. I do this. I give my tithes faithfully. I do this. I'll never have financial hardship. I go to church every Sunday, and going to church every Sunday is good. But I go to church every Sunday and then my marriage is going to be perfect. It's going to be bliss. I do this and God will do this for me. And then we get angry at God because he hasn't worked it out, but he's all about the transaction. He's all about the transformation. And he's willing, as a good shepherd, to do whatever is necessary in your life to bring about the transformation. You've heard me say it several times. I just have this deep sense in my own, for me, That God is much more concerned about my wholeness than my happiness, and I won't experience true happiness until I experience the wholeness that is Him alone. And that won't come from staying connected to everything else. It only comes from being disconnected. Because it's only when I disconnect from the world that I stay connected to the Lord. Look what he says, and when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. The sheep has to come to the point where it reaches exhaustion and an inability to resist. Have you ever tried to pick up a sheep that wasn't exhausted? Can you picture it? Mary Purcell sent me this video of this sheep abusing its shepherd and said, she's telling me, I know this is what happens. I mean, the sheep is ramming the shepherd. He's like, what did I do? That's where I spent half my life. What did I do? Sheep are not the smartest animals. Yeah, I hate to break it to you. They are not smart. But you just pick up any kind of animal, except for a little 12-pound dog, that doesn't want to be picked up. Because why doesn't it want to be picked up? It doesn't trust you. You pick that sheep up, and it's got full of energy. It's like, yeah, I can't trust this human. But what I want you to do, when that sheep wanders, and what are sheep prone to do? They're prone to wander. That's you and me. We're prone to wander. We're prone to try and find life where it cannot be found. And who pursues us? You see, when the sheep comes exhausted and lays down, finally it says, listen, I can go no further. I have nothing to offer you. I have no solutions. God finally goes, oh, happy day. Well, maybe he doesn't sing like that. Or maybe he does. I don't know. Some of you guys are just too square. Right? You see, the sad day for us where we come to the realization, I can't do it, is the happy day with God, because he says, finally. Because when you are no longer the source, you are no longer the answer, you are no longer the solution, when you have nothing to offer or negotiate with God, finally he can say, good. And he picks you up and he lays you on the shoulders, and you find refuge on his shoulders. You see, maybe most of these struggles that we go through in life are all about us coming to the end of our own strength, us coming to the end of our own resources, so we can finally rest and say, I don't know, but you do. So many of us spend so much energy trying to figure it out, trying to fix life. And then what happens, right? Now, this just popped in my head, and that's always a scary thing when something pops in my head. But you know what happens to most of us? Most of us get tired of trying to fix ourselves and come to the realization, you know, I can't fix me. I can't fix me. But we don't stop there. We say, thank God for a spouse, because maybe I can fix them. Don't you do it? You come to the place where you realize I cannot fix myself, so you say, thank God for the people that are in my life that I can at least try to fix them. And if you can't fix your spouse, well, then you can fix your children. Have you ever tried that one? Forget fixing your children. Go straight to your grandchildren. They have less problems. My grandchildren are so beautiful, and they have hardly anything they need to fix. So, you know, I can focus on. And what are we doing? We're saying, Lord, I have the answers. Lord, I have one who reigns over me. I have the answers for this problem. Do you realize, friends, that's when you're in danger? When you think you're the solution? And it's not, Lord, I don't have the answers for my life, so let me fix my wife, or let me fix my husband, or let me fix my children, or let me fix something even safer like society. Right? It's us coming to the point where you say, Lord, I can't, but I know you can. Would you pick me up? Because when we quit resisting, then we're safe to pick up and lay in his shoulders. And so if you find yourself today at the point that you're exhausted and you say, I can't go on. Lord, I don't have the answers. He's saying that's a good place for you to be, because that's when we experience what it is to be found. And that is cause for rejoicing. It's just the opposite of the way the world works. Jesus says the way to gain life is to lose life. The gospel is a message that is counterintuitive to everything we know in society. We think the way to be strong is get stronger, to build up and exercise and to get stronger and discipline ourselves. And he says, no, the way to be strong is to be weak. He says, where are you fleeing? Because sometimes people don't flee to alcohol, and they don't flee to drugs, and they don't flee to pornography. They just flee to their own intellect. These could be really scary people, because they think, I have the solution, and they want to solve it for everyone. But he's saying, listen, don't even flee to your own intellect, your own ability to reason. And I'm not saying your reasoning doesn't make sense. I'm just saying, listen, it is not God. He says, come and cease to resist, because that's where you experience the rejoicing. And foundness is the rejoicing part. Coming to the place where we say, Lord, I don't have the answers. There's no solution to my problem. You are the solution. And that is reason to be rejoiced, because that is what it is to be found. We use this idea, these concepts of lost and found, to speak about being born again and our salvation, and certainly that is a context. But I know a lot of people who are born again and going to heaven when they die who live like they're lost. They live like they're lost because they're trying to manage their own life. I hope all of the men will be a part of that Thursday night Bible study. I've been through it twice before and plan to go as much as I'm able to go, because that Bible study kind of reminds us, brings us to the place where what we know up here becomes experiential here. Someone said something to the effect that the longest distance is the 18 inches between our head and our heart, right? We want to know. But God wants us to know. He wants us to know experientially. He wants us to know intimately. He's not nearly concerned about what we know by observation or through knowledge or the accumulation of stuff. He wants us to experience him being life for us. The key is the sheep is exhausted and unable to resist, and it's 100% grace. There's nothing for the sheep to do. There's nothing for the sheep to give. There's no commitment for the sheep to make to improve and to do better. The sheep is lost, and gladly in surrender is placed on the shoulders. Surrender. I read this fantastic book on vacation. I think I read like 7 or 8 books in 10 days or something like that. I love to read, and I usually don't get time to read just for the fun of it. But one book I read that Bill Loveless and Paige gave me was Surrender to Love. I was like, you know, even though I teach this stuff and I don't always live and experience this, I have these resistance. You know, can I trust God? Can I trust him? I sat there and I was thinking about different issues, whether it's my health or my children or, you know, this thing and the different things that we worry about as parents. And I was sitting there one day and I'm like, Lord, can I trust you? And the thought is, Tim, you can trust me, but that doesn't mean I'm going to do everything the way you think it should be done. Does anybody else have a problem with this? Some of you, there's a few of you. A few of you are non-committal. Some of you are asleep. Right? Yes, Lord, I can trust you, but that means you should do things the way I think they should be done. God Almighty, the creator of heaven and earth, does not feel obligated to do the things that the incredible Tim Ekno thinks he should do. But can I trust him? Can I trust He who is love to be loving in all of His actions and to use all things together for good? Can I surrender to His shoulders where I rest when even I don't understand? Until we surrender, friends, we're in bondage to our false self. We're looking for an identity in what is not true to who God has made us to be. In our striving for strength, in our desires for independence, we are wandering and lost. And in that way, many people who are saved and born again are living as though they are lost. This is where the thief does his work. John 10:10. Let me share a couple of verses with you. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I come that they may have life and have it abundantly. The enemy does his evil work by putting the focus on you. See, this is man-made religion. Man-made religion puts all the focus on what you can do. Take these three steps. Take these five steps. Take these. Do this, and then this will happen. But the gospel, a Christianity, you've heard me say this before, but a Christianity that's more focused on the Christian than the Christ is problematic and not good news. The thief comes to do what? To steal, kill, and destroy. He wants to rob you, and he wants to put the focus on you. And the enemy is behind every message that the solution is you. Your behavior, how you can improve, how you can get better. Now, I hate to admit it, but I confessed in first service, but over the years, I have been known to like the movie The Godfather. My wife has questioned my faith, my sincerity to the gospel over this, but still, I think, man, this guy is messed up more than me. And in the second movie, and, you know, you're probably just a better Christian than I am, so. The second movie, his whole life, I mean, he's at the epitome of power in the gangster world, the elite gangster world, and is losing everything. And I love it because they show it. And what is his solution? He goes, I can improve. I can get better. I know I have it within me. And I go, oh, lost. Lost, so lost. The end of the third movie, I think it's a classic if you see it, he dies all alone. See, that's what lostness does to you. Lostness puts the focus on you. Lostness says you can improve. Lostness says you can get better. Lostness says that if you just do more and try harder, then... But to be saved is to allow the shepherd, the good shepherd, to place you on his shoulder. The thief comes to kill. He comes to destroy. He comes to steal what God comes to give you. And when the emphasis is on you, that's the enemy, the thief working. Listen, life only comes through surrender. Life only becomes experiential through detachment. You need to practice a spiritual discipline. I encourage you every day, have some time where your ego is set down and set aside that you don't need to answer your cell phone. Now listen, I am the worst. I am the worst. You send me an email, man, I got to respond. Because my great fear in life and ministry is getting behind. Because, man, once you're behind, you never catch up. Man, the world is... It's horrible that way. So you send me a text, you get a text, right? And you guys who know me, you know. Send me a text, boom, bing, done, mark it off. Stay connected so that you can manage the world that you live in and you live in lostness. You know, what I have to come to the realization is I'm not so stinking important that someone can't wait 20 minutes. I mean, I have to take my stupid phone, put it on silent, and I put the timer on for 20 minutes. And I said, this is me listening to the Lord. This is not the sheep barking orders to the shepherd about what he needs to do and how he needs to do it. I mean, I had a Christian come to me one time and said, well, I just tell God what to do. I go, I was born Catholic. I don't mess with God. But he came from a certain perspective, you know, and he was like, just command him. And I'm like, whoo, I don't even want to sit next to you. You know, that's scary to me. Yeah, the bolt of lightning, right? Boom. If God worked like the way we did, there would be bolts of lightning, but thankfully he doesn't. What does he say? He says, listen, come and hear my voice. Think about how quiet you have to get, how you have to be to hear someone's heartbeat. How are you and I going to live transformed lives as those who are the beloved of God until we get so quiet, so detached, that we hear the heartbeat of God beating love for us? That's what it is to be saved. That's what it is to begin to experience abundant life. Listen, I have no doubt that the vast majority of you who are born again Christians, you put your trust in the finished work of the cross. You know that heaven is your home, but why are you living a hellish existence between now and heaven? If I ask you as you came in, are you living an abundant life? Because the thief comes to kill, steal, and destroy, but who? The good shepherd does what? That Jesus came that we may have life and have it abundantly, overflowing. And we won't experience an abundant, overflowing life as long as the focus is on us, good or bad. Will you allow yourself to be found? Will you quit resisting? Will you surrender? In verse number 11, he says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The question this morning is, will you surrender to the love of the good shepherd? Will you allow yourself to detach enough? Listen, why don't people come to church? And I'm not talking about come to church so that God will love you. I'm talking about why don't we come? Because most of you have 100 distractions. And they distract you from what? Your foundness. You see, well, I got all these things to do and these places to go and soccer and baseball and, you know, whatever is going on in this world. And what is it doing? All of this connectedness is distracting us from our foundness. And we end up living as saved people who are lost. Because we think it all depends on us and what we're going to do. And all I want to do is that the abundant life doesn't come and it become experiential until we detach. Until we surrender. The love of God for you, friends, is unconditional. He loves you when you rebel. This is the true God. Right? The false gods of man's creation, they love us based on how well we perform and how well we do. This person's in, that person's out. But the unconditional love of God, the creator and sustainer of the universe, is what? I love you. For what? Because you're mine. I always think about how can this be, right? How could God love me like this? And I always remember, you know, especially that first kid. I remember when Ryan was born. Oh my gosh, it was a miracle. It was amazing. I love that. I was the most obnoxious parent in the world. I took pictures of him everywhere. I mean, not just one picture. And listen, if you become a new parent, one picture is appropriate. But a photo album is not. I had a couple of photo albums of him doing nothing but just being there, you know. And I used to think, oh, man, I love this kid. This is, oh, it's amazing. I love this kid. And how would he reward me? How would he reward my love? How would he reward my love? He would puke on me. One day I went into my office. I was still in corporate finance. I walked into my office. You know, because those days we all had to wear a suit. And I walk in, and my secretary's like, what's that on the back of your jacket? So I take my jacket off, and there is cottage cheese dribbled all the way down my jacket. And I go, and this is the way he rewards my love. I was talking to Lauren Lanier. I go, man, because they've foster parenting in this adorable little child. And I said, has he done the green blaster poop up his back yet? She's like, no. It's coming. All that poop is controllable until it blasts right up and out the back. Yep, that's what the kid did to my love. I'm sitting there going, man, you are awesome. I love you so much. And I did what any father would do. I stuck him the whole, he had one of those little circle things that, you know, they could go any direction in. I stuck him all in the tub and hosed him off. And man, I was in trouble again. That is not what you do, man. Seemed like the smartest thing to do. My point is, I love that kid, and he's 35. He has not always rewarded that love the way I think he should have. He should wait to do that stuff till his mother's in control. And sometimes you poop and puke all over the Lord God, metaphorically speaking. And he loves you. And he cleans you up. And he restores you. His love is unconditional and his love is undeniable. He laid down his life for you when you were an enemy. Let me give you just three more verses and then we'll close. I am the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And I have, other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice, so there will be one flock and one shepherd. He talks about a knowing, and the Greek is interesting because there's several different words to know in the Greek. One, a common word for knowing is what we know by observation. But when he talks about he's known by the Father and he knows the Father, he uses the word gnosko, or the qualifier, and what it means is to know intimately. You see, I'm very concerned that we Bible-believing evangelicals have gotten stuck in a transactional Christianity that focuses simply on what we know by observation and by reading. When God is calling us to a deeper knowing, a knowing of intimacy. Mary, when the angel visited her to say that she was pregnant with the Lord, she goes, how could this be? I have not known, gnosko, a man. She knew lots of men in her life. She just had not known one intimately. And see, this is what I want to ask you today. Are you stuck knowing about God? Because he wants to know you with intimacy. He wants to know you as the sheep that has finally quit resisting. The gospel that says do more and try harder is not the true gospel. The gospel that puts a focus on you is a gospel from the evil one who comes to steal, kill, and destroy. The true gospel declares what Jesus has done and invites you to enter in, to disconnect, if you will. Disconnect from the world so that I can connect to the world. Why don't we come to church? Because we got all this stuff going on. And he's saying, will you disconnect so that you can connect to the heartbeat of God? What a tragedy for us to go through and have right theology but not experience abundant life. Father, thank you for these dear folks, and I hope that I've been able to communicate what you put on my heart. Lord, bring us to transformation. Lord, I pray that right now we would just say, Lord, I can't, because at that point, you invite us into intimacy with you. Lord, I pray that right now you'd give, as heads are bowed and eyes are closed, everyone an image of themselves as a sheep. Lost, exhausted, unable to resist. And right now, Lord, give them a picture that you're bending over them. And in that state of lostness, that state of exhaustion, no hope, no commitment, no self-confidence, that you're picking them up and you put them on your shoulders. And now you're calling all to come and rejoice. Not because of anything the sheep did, not because of what you did or didn't do, because the shepherd found that which is his. And his love for you is unconditional. And his love for you is undeniable. Lord, let it be transformative in our lives. In Jesus' name.